All right, good morning, everyone. Thank you for the introduction. Thank you for your introductions. I can see people from all over. And just to let you know a little bit about me, I am a health educator, middle school, sixth, seventh, and eighth grade at Edmunds Middle School in Burlington. And what I hope to do today on this agenda is share a little bit of the purpose and background behind my action research project with MGI, which will be giving you an overview of a health equity unit that was recently designed and used for the first time this year. And in that, I'm also going to then zoom in on one lesson in particular, just to give you a little bit more sense of that. And then we'll pause there for some comments and questions. And then I'm going to share some initial observations about learning and a few of the projects that students created to give you a sense of what that outcome was. And then this is always a work in progress. So wrap up with some next steps that I'm thinking about, and then open up for you all to make some connections or extensions or challenges. So the purpose, really, the grounding and the inspiration, I had already been dreaming about redesigning a unit in health class, and seeing the work actually that the sixth grade humanities team does at my school, and then also the humanities team in seventh and eighth grade was what I went into MGI with last summer. And then having the real grounding with the equity literacy framework through Paul Gorski, I decided that the purpose here was really to design a new unit that uses equity literacy as the foundation and also as the umbrella of everything that we do through health class. And then I specifically wanted to analyze the extent to which really intentional anti-bias lessons change student thinking about the causes of health disparities. So looking at health equity and health disparities. And then from the learner perspective, what I was hoping learners would take out of this was being able to recognize inequities within the different dimensions of health that we look at. And then finally, the actionable part is to advocate for healthy individuals, families, and schools, which is part of the National Health Education Standards. So bringing that in and grounding that all in the equity work. All right. So when I talk about simplified notions of health, I think a lot of what I have done over the years in health education is really focused on this second, darker yellow band there around individual behaviors. So much of traditional health education is around diet and exercise and talking about prevention in terms of drugs and alcohol, learning stress management techniques, and so on. And it has always not really sat very well with me because I thought there's more to this, but how do I get there with middle schoolers to go beyond thinking that health is all up to them and them managing their sleep cycles and managing their diet and so on. And so I use this picture as an intro to the unit around talking about that band there of individual behaviors and factors, but then also bringing up this larger context of all the other social, economic, political factors, living and working conditions, and then the services and that go into our understanding of healthy individuals, healthy communities, and healthy nation. And this is also called the social determinants of health, which is sort of it's been a hard thing to access with middle schoolers. And a lot of the reading that I've done is even hard for adults to access. Like, it doesn't really roll off the tongue very easily. So I was trying to think of a different way to approach this. So with that image there, and then these inquiry questions were also what helped ground the unit. So the intro unit is called Health for All, and the overarching question is how much or to what extent is health determined by individual choices and behaviors? And we started off with a real understanding of what is the difference between health equity and inequity. So trying to get some solid definitions there, or disparity. And then this why question, which is often a challenge too. Why do health disparities exist? And taking a look at some of the different reasons that you saw on that image earlier. And then ending the unit with an actionable piece. So what is it that's important to learners and students to teach our community about health and equity? So making sure that that piece is built in as well. So here is the overview of the unit. I mentioned the definitions. So getting a grounding in what these words even mean in terms of health. So a lot of the seventh and eighth graders come into health class with some prior knowledge and learning through the sixth grade humanities program. And so it's a really great way to connect that to a different discipline now. So we watched this short video and really identify that health disparities are avoidable and unjust, and they are differences in health among groups of people. Then we do a specific lesson that we're going to look at right now called Unfortunate or Unjust, and then choosing a topic to investigate, and then, as I mentioned, that action piece, creating a public service announcement to inform our community and actually be able to do something to address this. Okay, so this is a lesson inspired, as I mentioned, the sixth grade team has this lesson called Unfortunate or Unjust. And the purpose of this was to raise critical consciousness. And so it's a series of 10 statements. And what we do is stand up or sit down based on whether students think the statement is unfortunate or unjust. And this is also meant to spark interest in what they then want to go and investigate. This is a link to those different statements. So here's one that addresses talking about diet. My school only serves the kind of fruit I don't like, so I never eat fruit. And for the most part, everyone stays seated. So everyone's sitting in their chair. This is obviously COVID adapted. Normally we would move around the room, but this is just stand up or sit down. We talk a little bit about the fruits that they don't like, just trying to get some understanding there that's just unfortunate. Like, that's not targeting any particular social identity group, but it might be someone doesn't eat as much fruit as would be recommended because they don't like it. As opposed to this other statement, there are up to 10 times more e-cigarette ads or signs in my neighborhood than in other neighborhoods. And so this gives a chance for anyone who's interested in exploring this topic more around how big tobacco companies intentionally target youth and marginalized communities through marketing and advertising. And so again, part of this is to raise critical consciousness and to also give learners a chance to see what are some different topics that they can then go and investigate.
I'm seeing a comment slash question in the chat, Lindsay, of I love the unfortunate or unjust activity and wondering if you connect it back to the rainbow in some way, like that rainbow visual, which there were some appreciations in the chat for that.
Yeah, that's a great question. So a lot of the conversation that I've experienced in the classroom when we do the unfortunate unjust is that students are able to make the connection to why something is unfortunate. So they are able to unjust. They are often able to identify the social identity group that is being marginalized. And so then we can go back to that rainbow graphic and say, this is an example of racism. This is an example of sexism. And so being able to put that in the larger context of that graphic. So then a lot of the language for middle schoolers too is to say that health also just depends on where we work, where we live, where we play, all of those larger society factors that can influence health beyond just our individual behaviors.
I'm curious, Lindsay, are there any common misconceptions that you noticed that surface in that unfortunate, unjust piece that you think it would be important for educators to know?
One of the topics that is offered in the investigation is around environmental health and environmental justice. And so I think one of the questions that is unjust, or one of the statements that I have in there, is that my community is next to a landfill, and this is the only place that I can live. And there was some really interesting conversation among students. And it's not necessarily at that point in time that we say, this is definitely unjust, but it allows for the conversation to happen where some say, well, that's just too bad that someone lives next to a landfill, not really understanding how communities are intentionally places where landfills are built or power stations. And so some of that, again, is just sparking that, raising that critical consciousness around what their thinking is, why sometimes some of the unjust statements would actually start off as kids thinking that they're unfortunate, that it's just, oh, too bad. All right. I talked about the different ways of just launching the unit. And then again, just adapting for the really short amount of time that I have with students this year. I ended up creating the investigation resources. So that's a link right there to what students had access to. And then you'll also see here, this was a Google form of student interest on which area, which topic they were interested in investigating more. And it's a lot, so there's a lot there, and that's gonna be a reflection piece at the end. I was really trying to provide a lot of choice so that everyone felt like they had something that they could access and interact with. And there were even some beyond this that learners came up with. So someone said they wanted to investigate equal pay and the income gap for gender inequities. And so we just added those on there based on what other interest came up. And from this, I learned a lot just about what students were interested in finding out more about, clearly the environmental health piece that I had mentioned, and then mental health in the criminal justice system was something that students were very interested in investigating more. So then what we did, so we grounded that in a real understanding of why these health disparities exist. And then they had a chance to choose one of those topics and investigate that more, and then create the action piece that we know is really important in this work is to, what we know is important is to be able to take action so that it's not just left with, well, we've learned about all of these inequities and now what do we do with it? So instead, at the end of the unit, what they had a chance to do was create a public service announcement. And these are just three examples from the variety of topics. And the kindness kits right there are what some seventh graders did to take action, which was of their own initiative. So they were investigating gender inequities and health in terms of not having access to or not being able to talk comfortably about having pads available at school. So they decided to put together these kits that have pads in them. They have a note to anyone who needs them. And then they just really did this of their own initiative. They ran with it and decided that they want to make these available for anyone at our school to pick up for themselves or for someone else. So that's how they decided to take action in this case. All right. So some sample takeaways. And this is, again, from a short Google form, just some things that students said that they thought was important from their projects. Certainly being able to have these conversations, so opening up the conversation, asking for help when needed, And then you'll notice the two on the right side, just saying whatever the topic they chose, they all felt like it wasn't talked about enough. So helping to raise awareness and helping to open up the conversation that is sometimes uncomfortable and not talked about. And so that was a big piece for them. This is just a sample, but then there was a common theme of that with all of the responses to the Google form. So my next steps, I want to be more explicit in tapping into prior knowledge. I did a lot of listening and observing from lesson to lesson, but I didn't feel like at the end I had a real, like, this is before thinking and this is after thinking that that the learners had for themselves. And so the next time around, I would like to just be really explicit about this is what I used to think and this is what I now think. And then I need to be more intentional and explicit and develop my own courage around talking about individual choice versus systemic oppression in terms of health outcomes. I felt nervous about doing that when we first came back to school in September because of the dual pandemics that we are experiencing. And so I wanted to be, and this goes to the third one too, I wanted to really recognize the tension of students identifying or self-identifying with these social identities and then the health outcomes that we know exist and not feeling like this is a done deal for me. So I'm always trying to balance that being able to talk about things that are uncomfortable and also providing that hope with an eye towards a more equitable future. And certainly finding my co-conspirators at school helps to have the courage and continue to develop the courage to do that. So those are the things that I want to keep working on. All right, so I would love to now open it up to all of you. This is a thinking routine I like to use a lot in the classroom from Project Zero. And just wondering from all of you in the room right now, what practice in your own classroom connects to any of the examples that I shared today, or maybe what new ideas or impressions do you have that extended your thinking, or challenges? Like, what is challenging? What questions do you have for me? And feel free to, if you have something in front of you to write down on, or just sit with it and think about it.
Lindsay and I work at the same school, but what I was wondering is the PSAs that your students made, I was wondering if those were something that you thought we could leverage with the sixth grade students this year. And after we've started working on our social justice unit, if you think that some of those seventh and eighth graders would be willing to present their PSAs or have a question and answer with the other students at our school, or what was the original intended audience for those PSAs?
I love that idea, absolutely, to offer it to the sixth graders. The original intended audience, what we did is put them together into a slideshow share out, and we joined with Hunt Middle School as well. And so they were able to see across all the different health classes what people did. And then we had a discussion from that, but I love the idea of actually, and again, this is all adapted for our hybrid environment, right? I love the idea of students being able to actually talk about what they did and have their audience be sixth graders.
Hi, this is Anna O'Neill. Can I ask a question of you?
Sure.
And sorry if you've already spoke to this, I was a few minutes late, but I'm a speech pathologist. I think about language a lot. So I think I actually have two questions. One is, how do you make sure that this is accessible to your students with communication disabilities who may not be able to express themselves as well, make sure that there's understanding there. But also the second question is, do you guys, I'm assuming just because it's Vermont, the majority of your students are white and able-bodied, and do you guys talk about how white standards of beauty can actually prevent communities from access health, because there's the idea that thin equals health. There's the idea that food that is, you know, supposed, it's more common in white communities, is healthy than food that is fried or whatever, you know, foods that are more common in other cultures, and how doctors may discriminate against people of with different body types and sizes, which may actually stop people from even going to the doctor. So, you know, I remember being in middle school and being discriminated against for my size. I believe, you know, there's already many people in your grades that are thinking about that.
Thank you for both of those. I'll answer, or I'll respond to your second point first. That's actually been a huge challenge for me in terms of the traditional teaching about food and healthy foods and what that means, and how to be more aware for myself, and bring that up in the classroom too, about how we can talk about healthy food is so much grounded and the white perspective and thinking about it. And so that seems like, as well as beauty standards that you mentioned, and that I could see that being a resource as well, in that the investigation resources that I put together. The one thing that I worry about with this unit is that I have so many different things to give access to, and I wonder if I'm doing enough justice to the depth of, and the challenge of really thinking about that and talking about that more together, because a lot of this unit relies on students individually investigating the topic of their choice based on the resources that we have, but we don't necessarily have or it didn't take the time to talk about each one of those individually, which is what we would have done with more time. And then your first point about access to the materials, which is huge for me. I'm always considering a universal design of what's good for any individual student would be good for all. So the resources that I did put together are trying to accommodate for that. So there are a number of videos to watch with different levels of challenge or support, articles to read, and then certainly there's more scaffolding in it as well around how to pick out three facts from whatever resource they've accessed, and then ask two questions and try to develop a big idea from it. I don't know if that completely addresses your question, Anna, so feel free to jump back in.
Yeah, no, that's definitely part of what my question was. So thank you for answering. Before I stop talking and give the mic to other people, I just wanted to say, if anybody's more interested in that idea of health and body, the book or any social media, really, where you can follow Sonia Renee Taylor and her work called The Body is Not an Apology, is for adults, not for your students, but it's a great, great resource on that topic.
Hi, Lindsay. I'm Tim Mulligan. I'm the principal of the Newark Street School in Northeast Vermont, and also the health teacher too. So I have a little dual role in there. And I was a health teacher first. So I appreciate the health teachers out there. And the challenges that go along with that position, right? And I just want to say I love your graphic, that rainbow graphic. It really made me reflect a lot on my teaching and like how so often I'm just scratching the surface. Right. And you've done a great job of connecting it into all of this equity work that we're doing too, which is fantastic. you answered the question I was kind of looking for, which was about resources, the way you talked about your last question, which I think is really important. And I struggle with myself, with my time, trying to provide really good resources for kids. So like I give them something to go after, right? A topic like this exploration, this stand up and sit down is so great. But those next steps of like, okay, kids are ready to dive into this work. Now, what do I have for them, right? So that they can really go after this. And part of it is teaching them how to go find it themselves. But I liked your answers, like just about the different resources, finding free facts, right? And what to do with those, with that resource when they have it. So thank you for that. My challenge, and I don't know if maybe others could speak to this, or Lindsay, you could speak to this. You're in a much larger school than I'm at. My middle school entire population is about 20 kids in sixth, seventh, and eighth grade. So I think about doing a unit like this, it would be all across. But my challenge is that I end up with students that are isolated doing this work. They're not working in groups. And I didn't know if you could speak to that at all, how like maybe I could support those students that it's funny, like most of the times, like I'm doing a project right now and my sixth grade group, there's 10 of them in there, and like nine kids chose to do this one thing. And then you got one kid that's isolated by themselves because they're passionate about that thing. So how do we support those students that are working in an isolated space on this and make kids feel good about that? So.
Yeah, thanks for that. That's a constant thought of mine as well. And so for this unit, I gave them as part of the survey of what they were interested in is also whether they wanted to work individually or with a partner. And I did let them know, or a small group, and I let them know that I would be making that final decision. So really trying to do that supportive work in the background of which ones did know they wanted to investigate on their own, and which ones said they wanted to work with someone else, like that was almost more important than the topic. And just trying to massage that behind the scenes, I did. And then certainly providing that support as they were investigating, like doing those exit tickets at the end of class to see, well, who did I need to check in with during the next class? Or that gets a little bit messy, but that was part of the process. And I'm okay with a little bit of mess, and then we sort of try to bring it all together at the end. So I don't know if anyone else has other ideas or suggestions, feel free to jump in as well.
I don't mind jumping in for a second. I think that is a perennial challenge with personalized learning. The more that we try to create opportunities for student voice, the more sometimes it can result in isolation if we don't create intentional opportunities for students to come together. So I think there's different ways to group students. So one way is to group them around interest, so what their topic is. But another one is, I think even for those students who are working individually, if you're worried about isolation, and sometimes students, you know, will say they want to work individually, but they don't know until later that they wish they had peers to and could be better off for it, is, you know, support groups or feedback brainstorming groups that can be across interest and topic, but can just be a resource with time carved out for folks to share what they're doing and or, you know, talk about something that they're maybe stuck with and get some other perspectives on. But thank you for surfacing that, because I think that is a perennial challenge when you're committed to student voice, is how do you hold space for community and relationships at the same time?
And it was particularly challenged. I was challenged by offering group work during COVID, because then I was like, how am I going to manage this? And so I love that when they can interact and work together, but it really changed this year. So just trying to be flexible with all of that as well.
I am seeing a couple more questions in the chat, so maybe I'll lift a couple of those unless other folks want to unmute. But I see one about, if you were to narrow down to one or a few topics within the larger list, to allow for more depth and processing as a whole class, what would you choose? Are there some that surface for you that seem like they would be especially rich or intersectional to explore collectively?
Yeah, that's a really important question. I'm even starting this unit again on Monday. This is quarter three, so I get three iterations this year. And as that investigation resource grew, it did become like, maybe it's too much breadth and not enough depth. And so I originally went into it with the specific intention of addressing racism in health. And then, as I mentioned a little bit earlier, around just like wanting to be sensitive, not knowing where everyone was going to be when we came back in September, was where some of those other topics came in. So I think I would, based on what I saw, the interest and engagement around would probably be the three that I used as the PSA examples, racism and health justice, and environmental health and justice. That was one that a lot of learners hadn't really thought about or talked about before. And then gender equity and health. That's also a nice segue into our sexual health unit. And so it was a really good way for kids to be able to just talk more openly and comfortably about periods and pads and tampons without having it be like our sort of formal sexual health unit. And I saw so much more comfort around talking about those things in middle school based on it being through a health equity lens than as opposed to the body parts and reproductive health.
There is a question in the chat about what kind, if any, pushback did you receive from students, families, or colleagues?
I just have to give total credit to our school and our other co-conspirators, because they have really done the groundwork for this. So the sixth grade and then the seventh and eighth grade curriculum this year is all around social justice. And so I didn't actually hear any kind of pushback. I think because that is already just such a learning point in our community. We've been talking about for many years. I don't know in terms of my colleagues how much pushback they get, but as a health teacher, I'm sort of a little bit on the fringe, and I didn't really get anything. There was just so much engagement, and I'm grateful to all of the people that are working on this together.
Lindsay, are there any, you spoke that the students had prior knowledge. Is there prior knowledge that you think that they would, is there anything missing from their prior knowledge that would benefit your class? Or what is an example of where their prior knowledge helped you that other schools that don't have that curriculum might need to add in order to be successful?
I noticed that the prior knowledge came up with unfair and unjust, or unfortunate, sorry. We changed the language from unfair to be unfortunate to unjust. The language around that with the social identity groups, they had those definitions really solid from sixth grade. And so being able to rely on that and tap into that was something I would suggest for other schools too, to have that connected with other classes. The other one, I included a resource, intersectionality in health justice. And so I know that there was parallel learning happening in humanities. And so in seventh and eighth grade. And so I knew that kids were bringing that and making that transfer of knowledge. And then just the real understanding of what equity is and the difference between equity and equality. I noticed it was actually great to talk about it in health as well, because we were able to see some points where kids weren't as solid on that because they needed a different opportunity to engage with it in a like different class, a different subject area. And so, I would say that, Ashley, is important to be just trying to connect across disciplines. I feel like that is just so huge. And I get the benefit this year because I'm going into everyone's classroom as opposed to having my own classroom. And I just get to see so much of what's going on and say, oh, I can tag into this. Oh, this is, I know this is what you're talking about in humanities, or connecting it in other areas. And I feel like that's so important in breaking down the walls of learning so that we can make those transfer of knowledge across disciplines.